All right, so we're diving now into chapter 11, dealing with what electrical stimulation truly is. So it's the foundation of electrical stimulation. These are the beginnings of helping you to really understand what we are doing in this program. Okay, so we start with the kind of the patient perspective here. So I have been asked this in the clinic. When you tell people you're going to use electrical energy to do some kind of treatment, they will ask you, is it going to electrocute them? People think you're going to injure them, so you have to put them at calm and let them know, no, we're not going to electrocute you. You're going to be fine. It's not going to hurt you, I promise you. Okay, so the book tells us the use of E-STIM for accomplishing therapeutic goals is not new. So we talked about that. One of the first applications is attributed to Luigi Galvani in AD 46, who used torpedo fish as well for the treatment of gout and chronic headaches too. So he was doing the same thing as Hippocrates back in AD 46. Hippocrates was BC 400, so Hippocrates well preceded Galvani, but Galvani was using this as well. This chapter will use standardized electrotherapeutic terminology defined by the American Physical Therapists Association, Academy of Clinical Electrophysiology and Wound Care. So that's the whole goal of this. We're going to teach you those skills. It does give some really important thing. It says the use of standardized terms is essential for consistent communication. So you'll find out that not all parameters that people set are actually the same. Like, we're using a device today that uses a pulse current, but it writes itself as a direct current. So sometimes people will say things without standardized language, but it doesn't mean that the things aren't good. So that's the goal for today, is to help you get this concept. Okay, so the book goes in and says the history of this is well documented. There are two fields that have emerged out of research using electricity. One is electrotherapy, which is the one we do here, where we're actually treating patients with the use of electrical energy. And then EMG is going to be used to diagnose and interpret responses dealing with nerves. EMG can be combined with an NCV, a nerve conduction velocity test, and their job is to determine if your nerves are responding at the speed that they should. So if a person goes in for an EMG study, they're going to do that, and then they do a nerve conduction test to see if your nerves respond as fast as they should. So some people's will, some won't. And we'll show you a video of that coming out of the break, so you'll know exactly what that looks like. Okay. I don't want to go crazy with it. So, therapeutic treatment goals. E-STIM is most commonly described by the goal for its application. So there's more than one thing we treat. So we don't just treat pain. We don't just treat muscle weakness. We treat a lot of different things with E-STIM, and it's usually going to be described. There are acronyms that we use to describe what we're doing as a part of E-STIM. So electrical stimulation or electrotherapeutics is the global term, but underneath the umbrella, there's a lot of different types of electrical stimulation. And the acronyms are found in table 11.1 there to your right. And we'll go through these as we get into them. So my goal for today is not for you to memorize these off the bat, so you can just say them to be saying them. As we cover them as a part of this class, then we will show you where they're relevant and talk more about them. So you'll learn them here as a part of this class. But all of those are the things that we will cover as a part of this class. We will cover TENS, which deals with transcutaneous electrical nerve stimulation, which is mostly used for pain. NEMS, which is going to be used to stimulate innervated muscles. Functional electrical stim for muscles that don't have the abilities to contract well. So they have an inability either due to a nerve compression or due to some type of injury. ESTER, which is electrical stimulation for tissue repair. We use this to treat wounds. And EMS, electrical muscle stimulation, is the only one we do not do in this program because it is the stimulation of de-innervated muscle. So remember we talked yesterday, de-innervation, meaning there is no nerve supply going to the muscle. And so because of that, if we want the muscle to have any form of movement, we have to stimulate directly into the muscle. So we do not do EMS as a part of this course. Something you may see clinically, but very rarely is it actually still being done because there's great research that shows it's not very safe even to do on de-innervated muscle. But we will do the other four as a part of this course. TENS, NEMS, FES, and ESTER. We are going to do those. You'll know exactly what they mean. Okay? So now let's get into the characteristics of electricity, because that's going to help us to understand where we're going with this. So it says electricity is most often described by its strength or its charge. So the strength of it deals with its charge. The rate of flow is its current. Its driving force would be the voltage, and then opposition, which would be the resistance. So I would think of it in this term. If you're looking at this, think of it. Anybody here use water from a water hose? So you plugged up a water hose to a spigot and you use a water hose, whether there's a sprayer on the end or not, you've used a water hose in your life. Great. So think of the charge or the strength as the water itself. So water is the charge. The current is how many turns you turn on the spigot to turn on the water flow. So if you do a short turn, you get very little flow. If you max it all the way out, you get maximum flow. So the water would be the charge. The rate of flow is how many turns I turn on the spigot to get the amount of water I'm looking for. If you're watering plants, you don't want to turn it on full blast like you would if you were washing your car, or you were trying to use it as a pressure washer. So the number of turns on the spigot is the rate of flow. Driving force would be the pressure of your spigot to release the water. So if you had some type of water blockage issue in your house, you're going to have a low rate of flow. I don't know if you've ever either gone to a hotel or even dealt with this in your own home, where your shower head starts to get clogged and you turn it on and it doesn't feel like any water is coming out. Feels like the shower head is TTing on you instead of really giving you a good flow. Nobody but me and Jesus. Okay. I think that's the worst feeling on earth. So you turn on the water and something is blocking it, so you don't get the full effect of what you're looking for. Like, it feels like the water is, you're like, good Lord, why is the water so low? The pressure is low. That's that. So that's the driving force. how much it's able to release. And then the opposition would be kinks in your water hose. So if you've ever kinked a water hose, you know at the end when you're holding it, the amount of kinks inside of the hose will determine how much water comes out. So the more you kink the hose, the less water comes out. You unkink it, it flows better. So if you think of it in that respect, that'll help you to understand what these terms really mean. To me, that's how I can see this in my head. It's like dealing with water from a water hose or dealing with water from a shower head. Same difference. I'm trying to get water out of something, and something is either blocking it or something is resisting it, and now the water is not coming through the way that it should. Okay? All righty. The relationship between current voltage and resistance is going to be described by what we call Ohm's law. Ohm's law. Ohm's law. Ohm's law. I guess before we need to get there, we need to try to get you this information as well. The book doesn't do a great job. So the strength of it is measured in coulombs. So when we're measuring the strength of the charge, we measure that in coulombs. When we measure the current or the rate of the current, we measure that in amps. So you'll see people using an amp meter to measure current. If you've ever seen someone doing a test light to see if something, if there's electricity flowing in something, they're using an amp meter. Voltage is measured in volts. Resistance is measured in ohms. O-H-M-S, ohms. Okay. That's how we measure each of these. Okay. And that leads us into Ohm's law. Ohm's law, which simply states current or I equals voltage over resistance. So current. Let's see here. So current is usually the way we represent current. So the formula would be I equals V over R. So the way we represent, so the I is current. So whatever the current is, equals voltage over resistance. So I equals V over R. Current equals voltage over resistance. I equals V over R, which means current is directly proportional to the voltage. The more voltage you have, the more current you will have, and it's inversely related to resistance. The more resistance you have, the less current you will have. The less resistance you have, the more current. So as with this formula, as V increases, so does I. With this formula, as R increases, as R increases, I decreases. That's the best way to think of that. Keep it simple. Don't go crazy with trying to do anything crazier than that. I equals V over R. Okay. So fancy words that go with it, but it's still based on that I equals V over R. So as current increases, so does, as voltage increases, so does the current. As resistance increases, it reduces the current. Okay. Okay. Any questions there? Gotcha. Okay. So, good stuff. Mm-hmm. Okay. So, now we'll deal with the excitable tissues. So, excitable tissues and non-excitable tissues both possess some level of resistance. So whether it's metal, which conducts electricity very well, or whether it's plastic, which does not conduct electricity at all, there is some type of resistance in all of them. Excitable tissues include nerve. So that's one of the most excitable tissues in the body. And when I say excitable, that's just another way of saying this tissue takes on current well. So it's not like the tissues are in there jumping up and down, yay, we're excited. No, excitable meaning it takes on current well. They look for electrical current so that they can perform their action. So the things that look for current in the body so that they can respond to it, nerve, skeletal muscle, smooth muscle, and cardiac muscle. So those are the ones that are excitable tissues in the body, which lets us know why we don't put, why we would not put an E-stem electrode over the heart, because the heart is susceptible to electrical current. So if you're trying to do something over the left side of the chest, you can interfere with the current that's already going forth by adding more current. So we don't do that. Okay. The opposition or the resistance of current in the body is described as impedance more than resistance. So we've already learned the term impedance through some other things from yesterday, but that's one of the best terms we can use. So it doesn't just resist, it impedes. It's trying to stop it from going forth. So that's what happens, why people tell you when you leave and you're going out into a rainstorm where it's lightning, what do people tell you to do? Wear what? Boots, yeah, rain boots. Why do you wear rain boots? They're thick and rubber. Very good. So the rubber impedes the penetration of lightning through the boot into your body. But if you don't have them on, then you're susceptible to having things happening. So you want to always think of it as impeding. It's trying to block something from coming in. Okay, the body's opposition results from a combination of resistance and capacitors in the body. Okay, capacitance is the ability of something to store a charge. Nerves and muscles are capacitors in the body, so they store charge. They pull on electrical current. It does not bother them. But there are other tissues in the body that are resistors. So capacitors will be nerves, and will be nerves as well as muscle, but other things in the body aren't as good at storing charge. They actually resist charge. And the way that they resist it could be in one way or another. They can either resist it in series or they can resist it in parallel. So we have resistors in series and resistor in parallel. The top up here is a resistor in series. So let's make resistor in series make sense. Resistor in series mean that the current is going to have to flow through each of these resistors before it reaches its target area. So it's going to have to flow through resistor one, resistor two, resistor three, and then flow to the target area. That's a resistor in series. Just like when you watch series on Netflix, anybody like series on Netflix? Same concept. You're watching something on Netflix, you don't want to watch the first show of the first season and then just watch the last show of the last season and go, I get it. I've mastered this thing. You watch it in series. You watch episode 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 so that you keep up with what's going on. That's resistors in series, just like Netflix. I have to watch each one so that it makes sense. It has to pass through each one before it gets to its target tissue. Resistors in parallel are totally different. These would be a resistor where the current gets to pick the one that it wants to go through based on the ease of passage. So for resistors in parallel, it's going to be based on how easy it is to pass through one or the other one. And it's going to take, the current will always take the path of least resistance. Current will always take the path of least resistance. Current always takes the path of least resistance. So when we're doing resistors in parallel, it's different from series. Series is going to have to pass through each one of those one by one by one. One by one by one. And then get to the target area. Resistor in parallel, it's going to choose the one with the least resistance, and it's going to pass through that. So knowing that, there are several tissues in the body that serve as resistors to current flow. Some are parallel, some are series. The ones that are series are going to be skin and adipose tissue. So no matter what, unless you shave off all of your skin and go all the way down to the dermis, current is going to have to pass through your skin and your adipose tissue. So those are two layers that automatically limit how much current will come into your body through E-stem, your skin and your adipose tissue. So those are two of the resistors in series. It has to pass through these. Then after that, we have resistors that are in parallel. And it's going to pass through the thing that's the easiest to pass through. One of the things I left off resistor in parallel there is nerve. So nerve should be above muscle. So nerve is a resistor in parallel. So relating to this, we want to think of what's called the ease of conductance, or what's the easiest thing for current to pass through. So when you see ease of conductance, think of that as me saying, what's the easiest thing for current to pass through in the body? What allows it its easiest way of passage? Number one, nerve, then muscle, fat, skin, and then finally bone. So nerve is the easiest thing to pass current through. Bone is the hardest. And what's crazy is they actually make an eSTEM device that helps with bone restoration that they actually put on patients. So you can pass current through bone. It's not something we do as therapy. I'll show you a video on that. It's pretty cool. Okay. So any questions there about resistance or impedance? All tissues provide some level of impedance, but it's figuring out which levels provide which type of impedance, and is that area something that's a resistor in a series, meaning it's going to have to pass through these no matter what, or is it a resistor in parallel, meaning it gets to choose what it wants to do. So let's look at current from how it goes so that we can get clarity on that. Oh, there. So if I'm looking at current, so let's say we're going to connect you all today to the eSTEM device. So we put the electrodes on your skin. We turn it on. We turn it up. The first thing the electrical stimulation is going to pass through is your skin. Next is going to pass through your subcutaneous fat layer. And these two are resistors in series, RIS, meaning it's going to have to pass through those to get down to where we want to get it to next. After it leaves the subcutaneous fat layer, then it proceeds to look for a RIP. Not a rest in peace, a resistor in parallel. So it's done everything it had to do in the series of resistors. Now it's going to start seeking for a resistor in parallel. Most likely it's going to be looking for nerve. If we can't find nerve, then it'll go looking for muscle. If we can't find muscle, then it'll continue to look for some other source where it can pass through. And then finally, the current returns back to the machine. So it's making a loop around in that way. Okay. All righty. Starting to glass over them. Okay. Take five. We'll come back at, let's come back at 9 and we'll pick up from right there.
The most controversial thing I am going to tell you all day, because I get more pushback on this than I do on anything I teach.
Okay, so get prepared for the controversy. It's not going to show up in this class. It's going to show up when you get to clinical. So the class won't be terrible. Clinical, you're going to have problems with it. But it will make sense once you think about it. Okay, so 274 again, it says tissue impedance varies throughout the body and conductivity of electrical current is going to depend on the amount of water that's present for in the tissue. So low water content makes it harder for current to pass through an area. Drier areas make it really hard to pass through versus areas that have higher water content. High water content decreases impedance and improves conductance. Healthy skin contains a layer of water and it has salt built into it. So that's when you sweat, that's what your body is literally sweating. It's water plus salt. That's why if you've ever tasted sweat, it tastes salty. Anybody? You ever been running and sweat drips in your mouth? And you go, what in the heck is that? Why is that salty? That's what it's doing. Your body is eliminating salt from its system through sweat. So there is a level of water that's already on healthy skin due to the fact that the body is trying to eliminate water and eliminate salt with it. Okay. Skin resistance is inversely proportional to its temperature. Highlight that star nine times. You don't have to do nine, but highlight it and star it, because that's the controversial statement. Skin impedance or resistance is inversely proportional to its temperature. And all that is saying in its fancy language is as temperature goes up, resistance / impedance to current goes down. So the warmer the tissue, the easier it is for current to pass through it. But on the other side of that, as temperature goes down, resistance / impedance goes up. Now, why is this controversial to so many people? Because therapeutically, we like to combine a lot of stuff to make life easier for us. So a lot of times, clinicians will combine E-stem with cold. And clearly, this is a proven statement, whether they like it or not. So that's where the controversy comes in. Because our students will come and say, hey, this is what the research says. And they're going to always go, well, this is the way I do it. And that's fine. You're going to hear that. That's the way that they do it. Just nod and say, okay. Learn from what people do. Your job clinically, when you go as a student, take the good things that you want to do and you want to be. Use those. The things that you see that you don't agree with, don't do them when you're a professional. But this makes more sense, and we're going to prove it today in an experiment. Not really. I mean, the colder the skin, the harder it is for something to penetrate through. So you've actually made the resistor in series a lot more resistant. resistant to the current. So your skin is harder and more turgid. It's harder and has less turgor when it's cold than it does when it's warm. So if you ever put a heat pack on something, when you go to remove it, the skin is pliable and easy to move. Well, it's relaxed. That feels great. Have you ever told yourself after icing, man, my skin feels relaxed? Oh, it's going to be tougher, a little bit more difficult to move around until it warms up. So you increase the resistance in series, which makes current harder to penetrate. So it's not the best thing to do, but it is what it is. People are going to do what they want to do. Okay. So don't go in and start yelling, but we were taught. Don't just, hey, thank you. I learned a lot. And it's okay. The book goes on from that to let us know heat. So it says heat increases moisture and surface salt content, which promotes conductivity. So heat helps with conductivity. Adds more water, moisturizes the surface, adds more salt content, easier for current to pass through that. Okay. Bone, fat, tendons, and fascia are poor conductors because they have low water content. Nerves and muscles are great conductors because they have high water content. Okay. Okay. Down from that. Impedance can dramatically influence your abilities to generate adequate response in an underlying muscle. The greater intensity of current would be necessary to obtain the response you're trying to get in an area covered by adipose tissue as compared to an area with little fat. So that's going back to that resistor in series. So the more adipose tissue, because it has to pass through subcutaneous fat, skin subcutaneous fat. The more adipose tissue we have, the harder it's going to be for current to pass through and get to the resistor in parallel, either the nerve or the muscle. Okay. And so the way we have to overcome that is we have to increase amplitude, or we have to increase the intensity of the current. So sometimes that'll make it uncomfortable. Okay. Minimizing impedance is important for all applications because it allows current intensity to be reduced, so it increases patient comfort at the bottom there. One of the best things we can do, we mentioned this yesterday again, cleaning the skin surface with alcohol before electrode application. It can remove dirt and body oils, which will help to decrease impedance. Removing excessive body hair will also reduce it, and warming the region will also improve it with this conductance, either a heat pack. It's talking about using a warm gel, but we don't use a whole lot of carbon electrodes. Down from that, hydrating the skin will also decrease impedance, making the amount of intensity required lower, which increases patient's comfort. So things that help to reduce skin resistance or skin impedance. It talks about one, removing oils or dirt. So things that help to reduce it. Yeah, let's do this. Reduce impedance. Cleaning skin will be one. Heating the skin will be one. And it mentioned one of them. My brain just shut down there. Oh, and having the patient hydrate. Water content in the body. Okay. Good stuff. Don't worry about that yet. Okay. Okay, so now we will jump to current or, stimulator output. The characteristics of current flow, that's going to be something we're going to use once we get to iontophoresis. Right now, it doesn't need to be talked about yet. This is something that we want to talk about because a lot of the stimulators, especially the ones in the back, are going to give you the option of do we use constant current or do we use constant voltage? Constant current or constant voltage. And there are reasons I use each one. So sometimes I'll go between the two, and sometimes I use different ones for different things. So we'll cover what the book says, and then I'll tell you when I kind of flip between the two. So the output of the machine can be classified as either constant current or constant voltage. When you start to turn up the amplitude, you're turning it up, and it's going to be listed as either current or voltage. Some will say CC, some will say CV, when you're getting ready to select your actual current. And you get to pick, do I want a CC or do I want a CV? I want a constant current or do I want constant voltage? The selection of constant current or constant voltage for treatment depends on the type of units that you're going to use. Some will have it as a choice, others will not. If both are available, the choice depends on the clinician's preference. It's going to be based on your understanding of the next two things that we'll talk about. A constant current stimulator produces a current that does not vary and is independent of resistance. That means the current is going to flow no matter what's happening to the resistance. So the current will never ramp down no matter how much resistance is increasing. So I say constant current this way. Constant current is like using, cruise control in your car. How many of you drive on the interstate on cruise control? Some people. Everybody has used it at least once, hopefully. Okay, good stuff. I don't feel weird. Okay, so if you're driving alone in your car, so let's say you're starting off on a flat road, you get your car up to 70, how fast do y'all drive? Closer to her, 73. We're recording, 73 is a good speed.
Why 65? I think it's quite
fair. On a 65? No. Yeah, she is speeding. She's as bad as we are. Don't feel bad. That is my vice. I tell people that. I always joke and say, man, I don't. Grace of God. That does wear thin though, so don't keep doing it.
Really
Don't keep doing it. Yeah. 80 and a 65 is aggressive. I don't think I even drive 80 and a 65. That's kind of you. Don't speed. I can't say don't speed. I speed. But be careful. You know, 9 miles over is safe. You know, you no more than 9 miles on a good day. You want to be careful. Yeah. Don't push it to 10. That'll give them a reason to pull you over. 9 miles keeps them off of your back. Okay, anyway, so everybody has used cruise control. That makes sense. Good. So if you're driving, you set your cruise, you're driving, you're on the interstate, you're 75 and a 70, safe. All righty, we're driving, the road is flat, car's just driving itself. What happens? Now you're coming up on a huge hill. What does the car do? It accelerates. That's right. The car will accelerate itself because it's going to maintain the speed you set. It's not going to go, you know what? You set me at 75, but I know we're going up a hill. I'm going to just relax off the gas and we'll just go up at whatever speed we want. No. If you set 75, it's going to accelerate to get you to 75. What happens when you're now coming down the hill? It will literally brake itself. The car will start to apply the brake to slow you down to keep you around that 75 mark. So that's constant current. It's going to go at the rate you set no matter what. Now, that's a good and a bad thing because that means you're getting a constant level of stimulation that's reliable. That's where it's good. Where it's bad is if something is going on with your electrode, let's say the edge is peeling up, let's say it's not really flat against the skin like it should be, you didn't tape it down well, and now there are some pockets in it where it's kind of elevated. Now, when you put it on the patient and you turn it on, you're going to increase patient's discomfort. It's going to start to bite, it's going to start to become uncomfortable, and they're not going to like it. And it's because the current is not going to ease itself in relationship to something else going wrong with it. It's going to give you the same level you set every time. So that's constant current. So that's what the book said. It remains the same throughout the treatment when the current level is constant, as long as the parameters are the same. No matter what we do, it's going to stay the same. The disadvantage is as impedance increases because the electro size decreases. So usually the bad thing with constant current is if your electrodes are peeling up, then it's going to cause for an area of skin receiving more current, and it's going to create a hot spot. So that's the danger of constant current. It's a good thing to have, but it could be dangerous if you're not monitoring. And we'll talk about that. Constant voltage on the other end. The voltage does not vary, but the current will, depending on the increase in resistance. So in the same scenario, constant voltage is like driving your car with your foot and not using cruise control. If you're getting ready to go up a hill, everybody except Anna Grace, chances are you are going to not push the gas harder to try to get up the hill. You're going to just kind of keep your foot at whatever level it's at. So you're going to start out at 75 going up the hill, but as you're going up, you may let it drop to 73, 71, 68, 67. Now we're at the top of the hill. We're coming down the hill. You're going to go from 68 to 75, 77, 78, 79, and then we level back out at 75. Make sense? So it's going to vary based on what's going on with the situation. So that's constant voltage. So constant voltage will alter itself up or down based on an increase in impedance. So if impedance is going up for some reason, the electrode is starting to peel off, the skin is starting to relax, it's becoming more moist, and now more current can get through it. It starts to adjust itself so that the patient gets a quality response, but it's not going to injure. So constant current versus constant voltage. One is like the stimulator on cruise control. One is like the stimulator with you actually pushing the gas. Now, when do I use either one? I'm glad you asked. So I like, for me personally, now there's no book science on this. This is what I personally like. You can try either way. If I am using E-Stim for pain, then I like to use constant voltage. Because if I'm using it for pain, a lot of times I'll do stim with heat. And what happens is, as the tissue relax, it's going to give me more current so that the patient feels more comfortable. They won't end up going, I don't feel anything. It'll ramp itself up to where it needs to be so that they can feel the quality of the current. If I'm doing E-Stim for muscle strengthening or whatever, muscle protocol, then I like to use constant current because I want the same quality current provided to the muscle every time. I want to know that they're getting the same amount of amplitude at minute one as that they were getting in minute 19. I want it to be the same exact way every time. So for pain, I like constant voltage. For muscle protocols, I like constant current. Slightly up in 276, the book says you can easily determine if you're using constant current or constant voltage by peeling the edge of the electrode up. When you can test it yourself by using two electrodes and then peel the edge of the electrode up. If you peel the edge of the electrode up and the current increases, it's constant current. If it decreases, it's constant voltage. Because if it increases, constant current is still going to fight to give you that same amount of current no matter what. Constant voltage, when it sees that resistance is increasing, it's going to pull the current back. Okay. Now, let's get into more fun stuff. So let's do a 2-minute stretch break so that your brains don't get bogged down. So everybody stand, move around, dive back in here. And we're gonna start talking about the types of current. The types of current. These are the types of current stimulators can choose to use. Just like you saw yesterday, some of them may have these, some of them may not. It really depends on the stimulator itself. So some of them have abilities to use some of these, some of them don't have them, but I at least want you to understand what's going on. So these are dealing with the currents coming from the machine. We already know in nature, and functionally going to the device, powering the device on, we can either have either one of two current types. We can have AC or DC power. If we're using DC, what are we using? Batteries. Very good. AC? Wall outlet, wall plug. Very good. So that's those are the power sources to power on the device. Now, once the device is powered on, there are current types that the device produces that can be used for patient management. That's what we're talking about now. So this isn't talking about the currents that we use to power the device on. We're now going to discuss what comes out of the device that the patient feels for therapeutic treatment. So that's what these current classifications are. So the book says, although eSTM are often referred to, eSTM treatments are often referred to and documented by the type of commercially named use, the clinician must be aware of the actual currents being produced by the unit. So sometimes people just list it as, you know, like you were saying, Neo Vectra and things that we did yesterday. But we really want to, when we're documenting this, we want to document it based on the current that we're actually using. And we'll show you how to document this the right way. All therapeutic eSTM units use one of three generic forms of current, or they can use all three, or a combination of the three. It doesn't have to be just one. Some, the smaller portable units will use just one. The larger units are going to use multiple at times. The three types of currents that it can use for patient treatment is DC current, alternating current, or pulsatile current. And remember, we said pulse current only exists as a eSTM treatment current. It does not exist anywhere else in nature. There's nowhere else where current is pulsed, meaning coming in and going off, just like you would pulse an ultrasound. Commercial units often name certain things like high volt, interferential, Russian, other things like that, but they're all types of current. So even though they have cool and fancy names, really they're types of, they're either a type of one of these three currents. No matter what the name is, it's a type of one of these three currents. The first one is going to be direct current. The way we classify direct current from a device perspective is going to be a continuous one direction or unidirection, so continuous one direction flow of charge particles or of charged particles, and that flow is going to last for at least one full second. So it's going to be continuous flow of charged particle, and when we say charge, that charge means it could be positive or negative. So where it says charged, just write out beside that positive or negative, because the charge could be positive or it could be a negative charge. So it's a continuous unidirection, meaning it's only going to flow in one direction. It's not going to flow forward for a half second, then turn and go backwards for a half second. It's going to flow one direction. Continuous unidirectional, one directional flow of charged particle, positive or negative, and it's going to last for at least 1 second. Means it will not be interrupted at all. It's going to flow continuously for one whole second and continue that way, flowing uninterrupted until it goes off. So the 1 second doesn't mean it flows for 1 second and then quits. It's going to flow uninterrupted until it goes off. So if we were charting direct current, it would look like this. So this would be 0 seconds. This would be 1 second. This would be 2 seconds. And then it goes on from there. 3, 4, 5. The current will come on and it's going to start to flow out of the device continuously for at least 1 second, but multiple seconds without being interrupted. Meaning nowhere in here is the current going to have a break in it where it stops. It doesn't break at all. So it's continuous. It's going to flow in one direction. It's going to be charged, meaning it's going to be positive or negative, and it's going to flow for at least 1 second. Uninterrupted. but continuously until it's turned off in one direction. Using direct current, one of the pins will be used as an anode, meaning it will be the positive, it will be the positive pole, and one will be the cathode, which will be the negative pole. One electrode will receive current from the machine, and then it will pass it to the other electrode, which will then pass it back to the machine. So it's a constant loop. And it also has the abilities to change polarity. Don't worry about that right now, because that won't make sense yet. So don't worry about polarity yet. Okay, here's the thing I definitely want you to understand about DC current and why we don't use it a whole lot. Because one electrode is always positive and one is always negative, there will be an accumulation of charge underneath the electrodes. That accumulation of charge will produce a chemical effect in the tissue, and it can lead to tissue burn or tissue damage. So because it's always storing charge and it's not interrupted, if we're not careful, it will cause tissue burns or tissue damage. So it's a very strong current. It does not go off. It doesn't interrupt. So it's going to keep building some type of charge the whole time it's on. And if you're not careful, especially if it's too high or it's not on the right patient, it can cause a burn. Okay. The two things we use DC current for are iontophoresis, which is delivering medication beneath the skin with e-stim. So iontophoresis, we're gonna be delivering medication beneath the skin using e-stim, and stimulating de-innervated muscle. So remember we said that's muscle that does not have nerve supply going to it. Only two things in therapy we use stim for, DC stim. Stimulation of de-innervated muscle and iontophoresis. Okay. Okay. So DC current, uninterrupted, for the full time it's being used. And it will not have breaks in between it. Similar to, you wouldn't want breaks in your DC current stuff that you use. Imagine, so you want DC current to flow continuously the full time it's being used, and not interrupt. Can you imagine the battery in your car if you drove for 2 seconds and then it cut the power from the battery? It interrupted. So every 2 seconds your car cuts off. You'd be really angry. Like, this is a sucky car. So we don't want, just like we don't want DC power in that way interrupted, we don't want it interrupted even for e-stim. For the things we needed to do, we need it to be strong and uninterrupted. Okay, the next current type we'll talk about is alternating current. similar to DC, it's also going to be uninterrupted. It's not going to have a break in between it for at least a full second, or all the way up until the current turns off. So it's going to be uninterrupted, where it's different from DC is it's not unidirectional, meaning it's not going to just stay one direction. It's not going to be positive or negative. It can be positive and negative. So it's going to spend some time in the positive realm, and then it spends equal amount of time negative realm. Positive realm, equal time negative realm. So it's going to look like what we call sinusoidal waves. So it's shaped like sinusoidal waves because it's going to spend time above the isoelectric line, or the line that determines the charge, positive or negative. So it's going to spend sometimes above that and sometimes below that, all in that 1 second realm. But it will never be interrupted, means the current will never stop flowing at any point. Same way you wouldn't want your AC current interrupting now. Nobody likes for your lights to pop on and off at your house. Anybody? You ever been in a rainstorm or something and your lights are starting to flicker and it cuts all of your electronics on and off 2 or 3 times? You hear all the stuff in your house start to beep that's connected to a power source that's AC powered. It beeps. Sounds like it's rebooting, and then it shuts off again, then it reboots, shuts off again. That would be interrupted. We don't want that for AC power, even when we're using it for the body. We want it to be continuous. Okay? Okay. The book tells us each electrode, so if we're using 2 electrodes, unlike DC current, where one will be positive and one will be negative all the time, with AC current, each electrode becomes positive for one part, and it will also become negative. So it's going to have both of them spend time being positive and negative. And the good part of that is it doesn't allow for charge to build up under the electrodes, which means it's not dangerous to cause skin damage or harm. Because charge is not stored under it, where it's starting to break down tissue, because the charge continually changes under that electrode, then it never will break down your tissues. We'll talk about which current types fit these. So AC current can be used for everything in therapy except wound healing. So it can be, well, and ion tophoresis. The stuff that DC current is good for, it can't be used for. So I will say this, the only things therapeutically I wouldn't use a AC current for was ionto, deinnervated muscle, and wound healing. So these are the things I would not use a AC current for. DC is only used for you wouldn't use it for anything else. So everything else you can use AC for. You can use it for pain. You can use it for muscle strengthening, muscle re-ed, and you can use it for FES, functional electrical stim. So it is a very diverse type of, it's a very diverse type of current type. So it's a very diverse current. We use it a lot in eSTEM. The third one that we're going to talk about is going to be pulsed current. Pulsed current. And with pulsed current, remember, this is a current that only exists as a part of eSTEM. And the cool thing about pulsed currents is it can pretty much do whatever it wants to do. I know that sounds crazy. It can be unidirectional like DC. It can be bidirectional like AC current. It's really whatever the manufacturer wants to use it as. But it can be unidirectional or bidirectional. It's still charged particles flowing, but the major thing about it is it's going to interrupt or stop current from being received by the body somewhere in that 1 second interval. So when we are doing pulse current, let's say this is 0 seconds, again, 1 second, 2 seconds, 3 seconds. When we're doing a pulse current, let's say we're going to set it up to look like DC. We want to set it up to look like DC current. So this is DC, continuous, not interrupted anywhere. Pulsed would be here going across, and then it's going to stop. Then it'll start again, stop. Start again, stop. Before this 1 second interval. There's going to be somewhere in here where it's going to stop, where the current would no longer press through. It will stop like a pulsed ultrasound. There's going to be a period of time where no current is going to be provided from the machine. It's pulsed. If you ever seen pulsed lavage, where the water is being shot out, there are periods where the water is being shot out, periods where there's no water. It's pulsed. So pulse current, the major difference between pulsed and these two is that it's going to interrupt somewhere within that 1 second range. So before the 1 second time interval is up, a pulse current is going to shut off for some period of time. It's not noticeable to you or to the patient, but it does turn off eventually. And the good thing about pulse currents is, just like with AC, is it doesn't store charge and it's not going to be damaging to the tissue. DC is going to store charge, which makes it dangerous to the tissue. Okay. All right. So that's pulse current. It could be bidirectional, unidirectional. It's going to still be the flow of charged particles, but it is interrupted in that 1 second interval. There will be some interruption there. It's not going to continue without being interrupted. If you look at your chart down there, figure 11.5 back on 277, you'll see what we're talking about there. So letter A would be how a DC current is constructed as it releases from the device. It's going to rise to whatever level, and it's going to maintain itself for at least a full second. After that second, then it can change its charge, either to be positive or negative. So that's what they're showing. The first part is positive, it's above the line. The second part is negative, it's below the line. B would be alternating current, spends the same amount of time above the line as it does below the line. And then C would be pulsed, where there are breaks in between the different blocks. The blocks represent a time period the current is provided. In between each green block, there's a space that represents the current being interrupted. Okay. Good place to take a break there. Take five. Stretch your brains.